Just to thank everybody that contribute, family, patients, students, friends, mentors, I'll try to go in there. Usually when we start to think about our model of our behavior in the world, all of us have this kind of a sense of agency, that is our subjective awareness that we initiate and control our own volitional action in the world. And the general feeling is that yes, I had the motivation to come over here, then I've done the cognitive design, what is the best strategy to come to this very displaced area in the world, Givat Ram, and then I've done the action, and now I'm speaking to you and giving you my ideas. So we initiate and control our action, and those of us that don't have this sense of agency actually are really in need of a good treatment by a good psychiatrist, for example, over here. And taking this idea of from motivation to cognition of to action, we see it in many basic science papers describing the neural circuitry in the basal ganglia, in the brain, the classical Mogenson from motivation to action, then Susan Haber, ascending spiral from the limbic part of the basal ganglia dopaminergic system to the cognitive part, to the motor part of the of these complex neural circuits. Nevertheless, I would like to share with you my feeling is that a much more parsimonious and more economic view of our behavior is the behavior that actually there is a closed loop of behavior. That is, if this is the agent, okay, that actually has a kind of motivation, motor and cognition, this agent is doing an action, motor action on the world is changing, and then in return, actually, we are having a new state that we are facing, and actually, all the time, actually, we are closing a loop between current state and future action, and we are trying to find our way in the world how to use this emotional cognition and motor information in order to enable optimal action, which is optimal motor behavior. And for us, again, using the word of Gazanica, we are our own interpreter. We believe that we initiated our action, but this is a kind of a very common delusion that we all share, that we are in control, but actually everything is part of this close structure between state and action. And if this is the case, okay, that we don't have our own sense of agency, and we don't have any know-all teacher that tell us what is the optimal behavioral action that we should do, actually, we should think about the problem of this agent, how we can find our optimal behavioral policy, taking into account that the goal is probably to maximize the future sum of positive and negative reward, okay, so to maximize the amount of pleasure, and we can go into more detail, but we are trying to maximize the amount of pleasure that we are getting in the world, and giving the problem that the feedback that we are getting is incomplete, because the world is noisy and changing, and the feedback that we are getting is non-instructive, is incomplete, and moreover, it is a delayed feedback, okay? It is not immediate feedback, it is a delayed feedback. Taking all this into account, actually, we are moving to the field of machine learning and computer science, and in computer science, actually, what we are able to see is that if we divide this agent, okay, that could be a robot or your friend or your cat, okay, we can divide it into two parts. One part is the action, is the actor that actually make the coupling between the current state and the action. Of course, this coupling should not be deterministic one, it could be probabilistic one, it could be very sophisticated, but the actor is making the coupling between, or the behavioral policy between the state and the action, and we have the more sophisticated critic that all the time calculate the mismatch between your prediction and reality. Okay, and actually we can start from zero with no a priori and just say this is going to be a good talk or a very bad talk, so 50-50. After 2 minutes, you are a little bit more clever, you know it is going to be a terrible talk, okay? Next time, so you change your behavioral policy, you will not come to a talk from someone from Enkarim anymore, okay? So this is the using the, so the critic calculate the temporal difference error, the mismatch between your prediction and the actual reality, and if this mismatch is positive, reality is better than prediction, you will reinforce this action. If it is negative, you will not do it again, and so on, so on, so on. And again, this kind of actor-critic architecture and bootstrap temporal difference algorithm really enable learning with non-instructive, delayed, and incomplete feedback. So we can overcome, okay, we can use this kind of exploration, a strategy with the environment in order to obtain optimal behavioral policy by an agent that use this kind of architecture and temporal difference algorithm. And the question that of course we should ask ourselves, do we, biology, have similar hardware and software, okay? So can we take this lesson from machine learning and look at biology? And of course, my answer will be yes. We have very, very good evidence that our biology can be divided into an actor and a critic. And the first is this kind of recording in the of neurons along the basal ganglia main axis, okay? And the basal ganglia critic, what we believe that are the critic of the basal ganglia. And as you may see, if we record the activity of dopaminergic neuron in the substantia nigra pars compacta and the cholinergic interneuron of the striatum, both believed to be the teacher of the basal ganglia main axis, and we give a cue that lasts for 2 seconds, the response in the critic is very, very short. Because the critic should tell you the prediction error, and prediction error by definition is short. Now you know already that you've done mistake to come to this lecture, okay? Only in the beginning there was a prediction error. Unlike if we are recording in the main axis, we are getting a very persistent activity that eventually couple between the state, the beginning when I gave the cue to the monkey, and this 2 seconds, and even now we are enlarging the delay to 8 seconds, a long delay when the monkey should perform the action, for example, to lick if it is going to be a food, or to blink if it knows that it will be an air puff. So this is transient versus persistent activity in the critic versus the main axis or the actor. And then if we are looking at the correlation, so if we compare the activity of pairs of neuron in the critic system, they will be correlated. Okay, so on the x-axis is the signal correlation, the correlation between pairs of neuron, ones are highly correlated, minus ones are anti-correlated, zero they are independent of each other, and you see that if we are looking between pairs of neuron in the modulators, the correlation is shifted to the right. That is, the teacher gives you the same teacher. It is not that one teacher will tell you this is a very good lecture, and the other teacher will tell you this is a very bad lecture, okay? The teachers are correlated. On the other end, if we are looking between pairs of neuron in the main axis of the basal ganglia, then we see that it is the signal correlation is centered around zero, and it is broadly distributed. And again, this was shown in many, many, many studies of us. The second issue is yes, do we do this neuron in the critic of the basal ganglia encode the mismatch between prediction and reality? And again, this is one example of our study, but it's been shown by many, many studies that when we give a monkey's cue that predict the probability or give them the probability for future outcome, then as the probability for future outcome is bigger, this is probability equal to 1 versus probability 0.25, when we give the cue, then the response of the dopaminergic neuron is bigger. Okay? So you may say, okay, but this dopaminergic neuron encode the pleasure because we tell them that now you will get a chocolate, okay, so they increase the response. You can see that this is a prediction error because when the chocolate is coming, when the reward is coming, then the response to the actual reward that follow cues with probability equal to 1 is the smaller one, okay? So this was already predicted. But if you get a reward after cues that tell you that the probability to get this reward is very, very small, only p equal 0.25, then the response is stronger, and therefore we have a good evidence that neurons that are part of the basal ganglia critic actually encode the mismatch between prediction and reality. So for us, the answer the question, do we in biology have the same kind of hardware and software as in the actor-critic machine learning? This is the computational, the machine learning device. We can now replace it with biology and say, yes, this is the main actor of biology. All cortical area encode the current state of the animal. So you visual cortex encode what you see, auditory cortex encode what you see, what you hear, frontal cortex encode your planning for the next action. This is going through the neural network of the basal ganglia up to the frontal cortex and to the brainstem motor system, motor nuclei, where we do the action, and the substantia nigra pars compacta. For example, the dopaminergic neuron in the substantia nigra pars compacta actually project this dopamine or the prediction error signal to the main axis of the basal ganglia. And the bottom line is that actually the goal of evolution is not to maximize pleasure, from my point of view, and not to minimize information uncertainty. The goal of evolution is to forward our gene to the next generation, okay? And actually, we've been tricked by our evolution, by evolution process, that we feel increase in dopamine as kind of our pleasure, and therefore our behavioral policy is trying to maximize the amount of dopamine in our brain, and by doing so, most of us actually follow the rule of evolution, and we are trying to maximize the amount of gene we forward to the next generation. So do I kill, or do we overkill, with this saying that maximization of cumulative basal ganglia dopamine is the goal of life? And my answer is no, we don't overkill, because again, elevation of dopamine level is the final common pathway of many, maybe all, drug of abuse, of intracranial self-stimulation, of brain pleasure area, that we know today that this brain pleasure area are the dopaminergic system. And moreover, if we are going to many common neurological and psychiatric disorder, we can manipulate them by manipulation of the dopamine system. So clearly, Parkinson's disease, we manipulate or we provide some help to our patient with dopamine replacement therapy. And if we are going to ADHD, that we treat with Ritalin, dopamine reuptake inhibitor, schizophrenia, that we treat with neuroleptic, that is dopamine antagonist and so on, actually we see the most important part of this dopamine system in our behavior, and therefore the answer to this question, yes, we overkill, but this is a very good first order approximation to our behavior, that the goal of our behavior is to maximize dopamine in our brain. So now let's go to Parkinson's disease, okay, one of this example of neurological disorder that is basal ganglia and dopamine related, and speak about it. And again, Parkinson's disease has been described about 200 years ago by James Parkinson. Actually, the first breakthrough in our treatment of Parkinson's disease happened about 50 years ago by Codias, that found that treatment with levodopa, a precursor of dopamine that can cross the blood-brain barrier, is very efficient for our patient with Parkinson's disease. And this is still dopamine replacement therapies, not only levodopa, but also postsynaptic agonist and MAO-B and COMT inhibitor. It's still the gold standard of our treatment of patient today with Parkinson's disease. Nevertheless, we know that many, many patients that with Parkinson's disease, after 5 to 10 years of treatment with dopamine replacement therapy, develop the side effect or the side effect of this therapy, like on-off fluctuation, levodopa-induced dyskinesia. And indeed, what happened is that in 1990, it was found in animal model of Parkinson, achieved by MPTP, by the MPTP neurotoxin that killed dopaminergic neuron, that inactivation of the subthalamic nucleus ameliorate the clinical symptoms of Parkinsonism in this MPTP-treated monkey. And since then, okay, 3 years later, this idea was taken to the operating room. We are using deep brain stimulation to mimic inactivation, and again, we'll speak about it in detail. And all over the world, more than 130,000 patients have been treated by this in more than 1,000 centers over the world. It's part of the Israeli national basket medical insurance, and even in Israel, you can get the DBS procedure in more than in 4 hospitals. So what is the mechanism of this DBS therapy? Okay, so the question that we are asking is, what is the mechanism? And as you may see by recent review, there are many explanation for the mechanism of DBS, and it is probably depending on the time after DBS turned off. But most probably, and I think that most people will agree, that the fast neuromodulation effect of DBS mimic functional inactivation of the stimulated tissue, okay? At least in this time of second 2 hours, most of us agree that there is no time for plasticity, no time for growth factor to be released, and we are speaking about mimicking inactivation. And the question that we actually, coming back to the classical studies that have been already done in the 1990s, how inactivation can cure, okay? So we are having a patient with a degeneration of dopaminergic neuron, okay? And we do another lesion and we cure his symptoms, how it could be. And the solution that I'm trying to offer you is that actually the basal ganglia are not the only connection between the brain area that encode the current state and the brain area that encode the action. There are one of many neural networks that are doing it. For example, we have the spinal reflex, okay, which is clearly a connection between state and action. We have the amygdala, HPA axis. We have the cortico-cortical connection, and we have the basal ganglia. But the basal ganglia are this system that provide the fast automatic default stereotypic subconscious link, or Daniel Kahneman system one. Okay, so if you go to Daniel Kahneman, he didn't care about state to action loop, okay? But he cared about system of the brain, okay? And he defined two systems. System one, which is the automatic default that we are not aware of it. This system that we are not, you are using now all the time and you are not aware of any actions that you are doing, just to the fact that I'm saying it to you now. Pay attention, you move, you scratch your hand. Now you will be aware of it, okay? But up to this moment, you've done many, many actions, okay? And you've not been aware of it, okay? And this is the basal, from my point of view, this is the basal ganglia system. And the problem is that when there is a problem in the basal ganglia, for example, following dopamine depletion, following the degeneration of neuron in the, following the generation of neuron in the midbrain, we are getting abnormal synchronous oscillation in the main axis of the basal ganglia. And since the basal ganglia are the default system, okay, we cannot ignore this abnormal activity, okay? This is the system that drives us all the time, okay? And if this system is abnormal, actually, we have to follow the abnormal commands. And therefore, when we do DBS and mimic inactivation, actually, we shut down the abnormal basal ganglia activity and enable the cortico-cortical system to compensate for the abnormal basal ganglia. So actually, what we are suggesting is that if the basal ganglia are malfunctioning, okay, if the default subconsciousness system, the basal ganglia is engaged in abnormal activity, we can compensate it by shutting down the basal ganglia and enable the more sophisticated, but the more slow one, of course there will be a price for it, for example, the cortico-cortical system to compensate for the abnormal basal ganglia. Important message from it is that the cortex system can compensate for the basal ganglia, but probably the basal ganglia cannot compensate for the cortex system, okay? So, unluckily for me, I'm not saying that the basal ganglia is the most important thing in the world, I'm just saying that it is the default automatic system. And therefore, the follow-up conjunction from this is that not all brain disorder are good candidates for DBS therapy, okay? So, for example, Alzheimer's disease, okay? Autism, which are probably very broad cortical disorder. I'm not sure about autism. I don't know what is the mechanism of autism. But let's speak about Alzheimer's, that we have a diffuse cortical, abnormality. Then, from my point of view, it is not a good candidate for DBS therapy. But the positive side of the coin is that basal ganglia related disorder, for example, human diseases that are affected by manipulation of the neuromodulator of the basal ganglia main axis, dopamine, acetylcholine, 5-HT, and histamine, and this include OCD, depression, and even schizophrenia, could be optionally treated by DBS. And moreover, we are not limited to DBS that will work all the time, okay? Because again, at least 5 years ago, we have shown that we can use the trick of closed loop deep brain stimulation. So we can record the activity in the basal ganglia, we can recognize this abnormal activity versus this normal activity in the basal ganglia. So over here, this is the synchronous oscillation, to operate the deep brain stimulation only when the basal ganglia misbehave, only when the basal ganglia are not working. And as you may see, the amelioration of the clinical symptoms was much, much better in the closed loop rather than in the open loop system that we give today to our patient. So the take-home message of this experiment is that the Parkinsonian basal ganglia can be observed and can be controlled, that closed loop DBS would inactivate the basal ganglia only when the basal ganglia misbehave, okay? So we don't have to inactivate the basal ganglia for all the time. We should be able to recognize when the basal ganglia misbehave and then to inactivate them, but when they behave, then we should let them do their job. That today we have our first clinical trials, okay, for example, by Peter Brown in Oxford, and there is a very strong industry that are going in this direction, so hopefully we'll have the real experiment in Parkinson patients soon, in something like less than 5 years, and, okay, and that we have avenue to continue because future closed loop DBS strategy, including multiple level sensing at home, the more sophisticated machine learning algorithm, actually mimicking the trick of the basal ganglia should enable us to give better treatment to our patient. And therefore, actually, the question that we are asking now is, can we take this message and move to schizophrenia? Okay, and I'm assuming that I don't have to tell this patient about schizophrenia with the positive symptoms and the negative symptoms and the need. And the need is because the onset of a schizophrenia is usually at the young age, not 60 years old, like the mean onset of Parkinson and Alzheimer, and still it is very common, something like 1% of the population. And today, antipsychotic treatment affect the positive, but not the negative symptoms, and many of these patients will be in the remote or the hidden parking yard of our society, in hostels or in a mental institute, not part of the general hospital that we are so proud of them. And therefore, the logic that we are having in our mind is that classical and atypical antipsychotic efficacy is related to their affinity to dopamine, to D2 dopamine receptor and the serotonin receptor. And therefore, as we say, that basal ganglia related disorder actually could be treated by DBS. And therefore, our strategy is to look for a primate model of schizophrenia using acute and chronic NMDA antagonists, ketamine PCP, chronic amphetamine treatment, having a battery of behavioral assessment starting with set switching behavioral tasks, blinking and social behavior in the yard, and do electrophysiology and try to do closed loop DBS in our monkey. What should be the trigger of this? So, for example, over here you see some results for our ketamine injection. And the bottom line, so these are spectrogram at time zero, we injected ketamine. And again, the take-home message is that if you look over here, you see synchronous gamma oscillation between the cortex and the basal ganglia. So we believe that this might be the optimal neuronal trigger in for closed loop therapy, and moreover, we can use this experiment in order to tell us why the basal ganglia are such a good treatment. Because if we are looking at the phase between two neurons, okay, in the cortex, they are broadly distributed. In the basal ganglia, in the external segments of the globus pallidus, the phase of a correlated neuron is actually very narrow distributed, about zero. Actually going in line with this idea of dimensionality reduction in the basal ganglia. So coming back to our starting point, okay, we believe that the basal ganglia are doing a kind of dimensionality reduction. We have a very broad information of the state, okay, what you see, what you hear, what you memorize, but you have to actually reduce all this information to what is relevant to your action. So when I see Oren right now, I don't care about the glasses that he carry, okay, or the color of his hair. I just care about the fact that this is Oren and I should run away before he coming with these two muscular people, okay? So this is done, okay, this is the proof that this is done in the basal ganglia, and therefore the basal ganglia are the optimal place to inactivate in order to get a very strong effect on our behavior. So to summarize, and again, I didn't have time to go into it, what we believe is that actually that the basal ganglia are not only trying to maximize pleasure, it is of course much more complicated, it is multi-objective optimization, it is not only dopamine, we have other teacher in the basal ganglia that encode the big manifold of behavior, but this is one issue, and then that the basal ganglia related disorder are often caused by abnormality of the basal ganglia neuromodulator or critic system, leading to abnormal synchronized oscillation in the basal ganglia main axis, that inactivation of the abnormal basal ganglia activity, either by ablation or by deep brain stimulation, enable compensation process by other neural network connecting between the state and the action center, for example, the cortico-cortical networks, and that the basal ganglia can be observed, for example, this by abnormal synchronized oscillation, and can be controlled because of this funneling dimension reduction anatomy, and therefore future therapy of basal ganglia-related neurological and psychiatric disorder, including the negative symptoms of schizophrenia, may be carried by closed-loop DBS and inactivate the basal ganglia only when they misbehave. And the final is our very ambitious mission today is to develop a reliable primate model for schizophrenia, because we don't believe that rodents have the same basal ganglia as primate, and we believe that experiments should be done first on animal before they are done on human, okay? To characterize the abnormal neural activity in schizophrenia and to find the optimal target. Is it GPE? Is it subthalamic nucleus? And the optimal strategy to ameliorate the negative symptom of schizophrenia by closed-loop DBS. And again, I don't know how many of you have heard about endurance and the transatlantic mission, and you are all actually encouraged to read about it. It is one of the great story of humanity. And again, probably this ad was never given, but still you'll find it in many, many places that men, and I added women, of course, wanted for other the journey, low wakes, bitter cold, long hours of complete darkness, self-return, doubtful honor and recognition in event of success. Clearly, will not be successful with our attempt to cure the negative symptoms of schizophrenia, but we should try. And many thanks, and this is the end.